There's lots of ways to sync files between servers, but I'm old school, so I just stick with rsync. The basic syntax is rsync, then your option flags, then the source file or directory, then the destination directory. Rsync, options, source, destination. That's how we use rsync. That's right. It's time for another exciting little Linux lesson. rsync's been around since 1996, so chances are good that it's available for your Unix or Unix-like system. It's also easily implemented in scripts and via cron, making it very convenient for folks looking to schedule backups. You might have to install rsync on your system via your package manager. But it's packaged for just about every distro I can imagine, as well as for non-Linuxes like the BSDs and macOS. There's even Windows binaries, but you? If I was using Windows and wanted rsync, I'd look at WSL instead. You'll have to install rsync on both the source and destination systems, which is typically in the package called rsync. You'll also need OpenSSH installed for basic use over a network, and OpenSSH server in order to receive files from another machine. I covered that in a previous video, and I'll put together more detailed instructions over on my website, vkc.sh. I'll also answer questions from patrons and Ko-fi supporters in a future live stream, as monthly sustainers make unsponsored videos like these possible. You heard how I invoked rsync earlier. You type rsync, then insert the various option flags. We'll start with --dry-run, which just simulates the process for you before actually copying anything. I'll also use --av, which is two flags. Archive mode consolidates this alphabet soup of common flags, including recursion, into a single flag for easier use. And verbose mode, which shows me more info about what rsync is doing while it's working. Then I specify the source directory, which in my case is a directory containing my RetroTube novelty rock band's latest record, Return from Interrupt. Lastly, the destination directory, which I can access via SSH using the username band at the server thestopbits.lan, followed by a colon, then the path which will get the files. Now, because I used dry run, it's not going to send any files, but it'll tell me lots of information about what it would have sent. This is important when you're building a new routine with rsync, as it will help you fine-tune what you do before you end up accidentally copying the wrong directory or deleting your backups. For example, I might want to move the contents of this directory over to the destination, but not the directory itself. In that case, I'd add a slash to the end of the source to tell rsync to look inside the directory and not at the directory itself. Running it again, I can easily see what it's planning to do, no longer creating files inside a subdirectory. Once you're confident it's moving what you want where you want it, remove that dry run flag and let it rip. Now the files on my local machine are copied over to the other machine, which is pretty neat. Modern rsync uses SSH to handle this connection, but on older implementations, you may have to manually specify SSH with a flag. If you're using a recent distro, though, you probably don't have to worry about that. And you may have noticed that I set the source as my local machine and the destination as my remote system. This is generally considered best practice, what we call a push instead of a pull. But you can invert this to pull the files from a remote machine down to your local system. I always caution against pull maneuvers when using the --delete option, a flag which will remove files from the destination when they aren't present on the source. This option is super helpful when trying to keep two directories in sync with one another, as deleted or renamed files in the source directory will be reflected in your destination. One problem with using delete with a pull-down when the source directory is remote and the destination is local is that you can't easily see if your remote drives are mounted correctly. For example, an unmounted drive might show up as an empty directory, and with careless use of the delete flag, you could accidentally delete files that you aren't intending. This is why dry run is important when you're manually invoking rsync. And for automated tasks like recurring offsite backup, I use rsync in a bash script which will check if the directory is empty and then alert me before something goes wrong. But that's a topic for a future video. When I manually invoke rsync to backup directories, the delete flag is vital if I want to remove old cruft from the backup. Just make sure you check it with a dry run first. Another flag I use frequently is the lowercase z option, which compresses the file before transferring it. This is super useful when you're dealing with a slow network, as it's going to be sending smaller, compressed files over the wire, instead of larger, uncompressed files. This comes with a sometimes significant performance penalty, though, and if your source or destination have slow processors, you could find that you're waiting a while for those files to move. A tip I recommend when dealing with slow network transfers like this is to fire up tmux and start rsync there. If your session is in tmux, you can close the session window easily without quitting the rsync process, then reattach to it later to see how things have progressed. I'll talk about that more on my blog, and as always, the man page is your friend. Now, I can already hear the comments. But Veronica, why not use something newer than rsync instead? Honestly, there are a lot of great options for transferring files between systems. And rsync does have some limitations, particularly that it's single-threaded. While its ubiquity makes it the best tool to use in many instances, yeah, if speed is your concern and you're working with up-to-date distros, you might want to have a look at something a little faster, like rclone, which I'm planning on covering in a future video. But no matter what, rsync is going to be around a while, and as an admin or home labber, you're probably going to be running into it in scripts and tutorials for years to come. It's an excellent thing to have in your back pocket because it's available on nearly every Linux distribution. Because Linux is awesome. And so are you.
1, 2, 3, 4!
If you're still watching, go check out Bread on Penguin's recent video about rsync, which covers some more advanced details. And while you're there, give her a like and subscribe. You'll be glad you did.